You're not going to want to miss the next episode of the AI Show, where we talk all about computer vision for digital scientists. Make sure you tune in. Hello and welcome to this episode of the AI Show. We're talking all about computer vision for digital scientists with two special guests and the coolest part. Well, let's start with you, Randy. Why don't you tell us who you are and what you do?
Yeah, my name's Randy Price. I work at the LSU Ag Center, and we've been interested in newer things coming up called digital agriculture, and also goes with digital science. So
that's cool. Alicia.
Hi, I'm Alicia Moniz. Before joining Microsoft, I was an AI Microsoft MVP and got the opportunity to co-author one of the cognitive services books. And I'm delighted to be able to get hands-on with some of the new features in version 4.0. So thank you for having me.
And for those that do not know, Alicia and I went to the same school and graduated the same year. We are products of the same university. So I'm so glad you could be with us, Alicia.
Thank you.
All right, let's start with the problem. Randy, can you tell us what we're talking about today?
Yeah, what we're talking about is we got a lot of tools for seeing things in the field. You know, we can take a drone and fly up real high and make a map, and we kind of know where a bad and a good area is, but we just really can't diagnose it from that. So on the next slide, we'll show you where we can also take those drones and fly way down low to the ground. And we do this out in the field routinely, like all the time, and get really close up images. Now, the next step is we either have to send somebody out there to, you know, see what the actual problem was, or what we would like is some of the people who are good at AI and machine vision to build us some software that will analyze these images automatically. And things we're looking for are differences in color. We're looking for holes in the leaves, damage, and stuff like that.
That's cool. So that's what I was going to ask. What is it that you're looking for when you're flying over? Because obviously this is an agricultural problem, but as you're taking pictures, what is it that you're looking for and what kind of alerts do you want?
Yeah, a lot of times you're looking for physical damage. I mean, when it comes to worms and some things like that and certain types of bugs, they will actually chew on the leaves. So you'll see that physical damage. Now, there's another thing we look at, and it's in terms of color. It isn't always how green it is. Sometimes we do like what's called an index or an indices, where we'll take a ratio of some of the colors. We found like green minus red is a really good one. And that tells you kind of how well the plant is doing biologically. You know, if it's low on like nitrogen or water or something like that, it'll get more of a yellow tinge to it. There's something called chlorosis, and you'll see that in some of the soybean plants we're going to show you, where it'll get like a real yellow spiny look on the leaf, and it's from lack of some nutrients like manganese or iron.
And that's cool. So you need software. Sorry, I'm hearing myself. You need software because there's so much of this agriculture, so many fields. The fields are so large that it's better to have a computer analyze these images and tell you where there might be trouble spots. Is that the problem we're looking at?
Yep, that's right, Seth. We have been working on a camera system that we put on a tractor, and there's some other people doing the same thing. We actually recorded a field where we recorded a high-res image of every plant in the field, 65 gigabytes of data in one time. So, you know, that's not that much. It's going to get bigger than that. But it's impossible for me to look at the 20,000 images that we recorded to find, you know, plants that are, have problems or damage. And we would like machine learning algorithms that could do that automatically.
I mean, and that's really cool, because now we're taking the problem of agriculture and we're moving it over to the digital space. So Alicia, how did you help him out with that?
So thank you. And it's been fantastic working with both LSU Ag Center and Dr. Price on talking through the use case and talking through possible solutions. And being the computer vision enthusiast that I am, I thought it would be a fantastic opportunity for us to walk through some of the new capabilities in the Vision Studio that was released and walk through a little bit of Python code using Azure Data Studio. And we can go ahead and take a look at what the actual classifier looks like via CustomVision.ai. So as a refresher, or for some of our researchers who are attending who are not as familiar with the cognitive services, what we'll be talking about today is the CustomVision service. So cognitive services will let you perform some predefined activities via the computer vision API. But what we're actually going to do is we're going to go ahead and create our own data set and use that to train our own classifier. And that'll be done via the CustomVision API. So I've done this in the past for event detection. So it's both object and event detection, where what we're doing is we're trying to kind of ask a binary question, yes or no. Is something occurring or is something not occurring? Now, we can go ahead and try out these tools without any programming on our own via the newly announced Vision Studio. And if you go to the featured tabs, there's a remove background from images icon on the right-hand side. And that is what we're working with today. So Randy and I were looking at some of the pre-processing activities that is generally performed on the images. And we get better results from the images when there's a starker contrast between the colors of the leaves and the not having a brownish background at the bottom of the image. So one of the newly released features in Cognitive Services 4.0 is the ability to remove background from images. So I do have a bit of a notebook that I can go ahead and share with you to kind of walk through how that code looks like. And you can see that I've already created variables for my endpoint and key for my cognitive services. You can go ahead and install the Azure AI Vision SDK. And what we can go ahead and do is we can use a URL reference to the image, or we can pass the image locally. And here we're just sending the file to the image analyzer function within the SDK. So what this does is we've already created our cognitive service in Azure, and it's running and it's waiting for us to pass either an image or a text file so that it can return back the result set. So what this function is expecting is it'll expect a JPEG or a PNG file, and it'll perform the manipulations and it'll return back a file locally for you to continue processing.
So is this part removing the background currently, or what is this part doing?
Yes. So what this part is doing is it is sampling between pixels within the file, and depending on the contrast, it'll go ahead and remove the parts of the image where it's determining it's not part of the foreground.
Got it. So it's like a pre-processing step for doing other things in the custom vision. Is that right?
Yes. Most research and analysis that involves images requires pre-processing, just like we usually process for outlying data. Like, there's usually some type of cleaning that we'll have to do against binary data. And the same thing goes with some of our image data. And, you know, there really is an onus to go in there and kind of filter out some of the outlying information. And when we're building our training sets, we can take into consideration, you know, what are the use cases that are likely to occur, and then prefer to use those for training versus kind of not as common use cases.
That makes a ton of sense. It's like pre-processing the data to make the actual task on the images, which is discovering challenges with agriculture, much easier.
Yes.
Got it. Cool. And now, once you do this pre-processing, what's the next step?
So the next step would be to build a data model that's able to kind of help us. And it's kind of interesting because when we look at bias, and Seth, I know we have been joking previously about, you know, now everybody knows I have astigmatism. Mm-hmm. So sometimes when I look at variations between smaller items in images, it's a little harder for me to differentiate between color.
Right.
And when we have these types of human conditions that affect our perception of data or media assets, you can really see how having a computer kind of automatically make those labelings is going to be a lot more helpful than having somebody who... So for me, my eyes get tired in the afternoon, and maybe if I'm part of the group that's labeling and classifying the training data sets, I have higher accuracy in the morning and lower accuracy in the afternoon. And it's just because my eyes are a little strained by then. But if you have a computer that is able to go through and do the classifications, then you won't have that bias affecting some of these automated activities.
That's cool.
So what we were looking at is, so data augmentation is one of these new tools coming out that are really helping researchers to kind of expand their testing abilities. And usually we say, you know, data out is only as good as data in. So you know what? Sometimes I'm limited by the data I have access to as far as what can I do research on. So data augmentation is one of those things where we now have a little bit more ability to create these scenarios. And our friends at OpenCV helped me with generating some testing images, and they took a few images and extrapolated using their software, and they were able to give me a kind of a range of colors for me to use so that I could build my three testing use cases, and then I could go ahead and use those to perform my quick tests against existing images that Randy and his team are collecting out in the field. So I can go ahead and open up that model, and we can take a quick look.
So as you're getting that open, you're basically creating new images that have different shades of colors to augment the data you're using to train your model and to test it. Is that right?
Yes, and sometimes we don't have data for all the use cases. So we'll have a set of data at our availability, but because we have a predefined set, we're really limited in gaining insights about that existing set of data. And this is a common issue or a challenge with machine learning algorithms is you get to know more about the data sets that you already have access to, right? So how do you build a machine learning model that is more inclusive?
That makes sense. So what are we looking at here?
Yeah, so what I went ahead and did was I established three different levels as far as the range of chlorosis, yellow chlorosis that the different colors were representing. So I did level 1, 5, and 10. And there's there's different things that once you go through testing, you're like, okay, well, this might work a little bit better. And what I can do is I can go ahead and upload one of the images provided from the field, and then I'm definitely trending more towards the level one. And the probability range is probably a little higher than I'd like it to be. So there's different thoughts that I've had as far as using the probability percentage to kind of help me build my range versus building the range by uploading 10 different levels of image variations, if that's fair. But right now we're looking at 3 tags for 3 levels and definitely trending more towards level one, which would be the lowest. And looking at my training data set, the yellow might be a little overly exaggerated when compared to some of the field images. So I think that definitely affected my levels too.
Got it. And what did the levels represent?
Yeah, so it's common in scientific research for scales to be 1 through 10. Mm-hmm. So when they're defining problem statements, they try to create that unit of measure as far as if we're verifying a condition, what level of condition would that be?
That's cool.
So 1 would be green and 10 would be extremely yellow.
Got it. Got it. That makes sense. So once this is all figured out, are we just trying to figure out the yellow content in the images to indicate whether a plant is struggling or not struggling? Or what is it that we're trying to find?
Yeah, so sometimes it is just that yellow color. Like we have some fields, we were looking at some yesterday and today that they had the yellow chlorosis in certain parts of the field. And, you know, sometimes it's as simple as just identifying how much area has that and doesn't have that. That was a field we were going to use for research. And then when we looked at it, we're like, maybe we don't want to use that one, you know, because of the difference that exists in it. You know, and the next steps would be make a map of it, which these algorithms will help us do. And then hopefully we can treat that and treat it site specifically in the areas that need treatment. So.
And sorry, that's just amazing to me how we're using these drones to figure, and usually it would have had to be someone was walking and looking at all these leaves, and there's not enough time to do that. Is that right, Randy?
Yeah. There's some farms in Florida that encompass like probably 75,000 acres. So just in order to drive to one side of the farm to the other, you could have an hour and a half, 2 hour drive. So the more you can digitize it and get in a computer and get people to look at it, the better off we're going to be.
And that's amazing. Alicia, where can people go to find out more about this?
Yeah, so I definitely want to call out Serge Retkowsky's GitHub. And he has some amazing workbooks out there, and they're very direct and to the point, and you can get up and running with computer vision or custom vision very quickly. So definitely check that out. And CustomVision.ai has a really easy to use UI where you can go ahead and build your classifier, and definitely the Vision Studio. And I do want to call out that there are direct links to the API documentation within Vision Studio. So definitely look out for those links.
Well, this has been impressive. Thank you so much for your time, my friends.
Thank you for having us on.
Thank you so much for watching. We're learning all about computer vision for digital scientists, a real use case that actually affects lives. Thank you so much for watching, and hopefully we'll see you next time. Take care.